So I was walking through the streets of Tokyo, and I saw this ad for a thing called a collagen capsule that looks like a red light emitting tanning machine that is supposed to reduce your fatigue, improve your skin, and anti-age you.
寝ているだけで全身プルプル。
This wasn't too surprising, as I've seen many other random beauty products and machines over here, but what was surprising was when my friend said he broke a bone in his hand. To improve the healing process, his doctor had him come in several times over the course of a couple months to put his hand under a red light device. So this got me curious. What's going on with red light? To understand light, we need to take a look at American football. The idea of the game is to get the ball on this side more than the other guy gets the ball on that side. For many players, a consequence of doing this is repeated head trauma and concussions.
For Iron Mike, TV interviews became impossible.
Hell, I don't know what I'm saying. I'm just tired and confused right now. That's why I say it. I can't say it the way I want to say it.
He would forget, you know, which way the grocery store was, which way it was to go home. He said, you know, the worst thing is I'm actually getting to the point where I'm cold and I don't realize that I can fix it by putting a jacket on.
When Dr. Bennett Omalu performed the autopsy of former Pittsburgh Steelers player Mike Webster in 2002, he found distinct changes in the brain that had to have been the result of repeated blows to the head. In 2005, football player Terry Long committed suicide. Dr. Omalu examined his brain and found so much buildup of a specific damaging protein that the 45-year-old's brain looked more like a 90-year-old brain with advanced Alzheimer's. Larry Carr is yet another football player whose brain suffered from the repeated trauma caused by hits to the head. Years after his 10-year football career in the 70s ended, his symptoms began with language problems, which progressed into severe emotional dysregulation, depression, agitation, and paranoia. Fortunately, he found a way to improve his brain health after coming into contact with Professor of Neurology Dr. Margaret Nasser, who included Larry in a trial of shining red light to the head to restore brain function. After 18 weeks of this unusual treatment, his brain health actually improved significantly. His emotional outbursts and depression scores had gone way down, which drastically improved his quality of life and suggested that the damage done to his brain was somehow being repaired by this light. Now, hold up, I can already hear y'all's skepticism gears turning away. Come on, how could light reverse brain damage? There's actually a surprising amount of science and history behind this light therapy. So, light and different wavelengths of light affect us in all kinds of ways. As you know, sunlight simply hitting the skin allows the body to create vitamin D. Blue light, in particular wavelengths around 460 to 480 nanometers, affects the body's circadian rhythm, keeping you awake at night. Hence, there are blue light blocking glasses and blue light filtering softwares that are supposed to help you sleep. Maybe you've heard of seasonal affective disorder, SAD, where people in regions of the world where there is too little sunlight during the winter get symptoms of depression. One simple yet effective treatment for this disorder is just exposing the person to a bright light during the day. Nowadays, red and near-infrared light devices are becoming popular. This red light therapy is thought to have beneficial effects for everything from reducing inflammation and reducing recovery time after exercise, to increasing collagen production, which gives you better-looking skin, and there's even claims that red light raises testosterone. Ben Greenfield wrote a popular article for Men's Health back in 2017 titled, "I Put a Giant Red Light on My Balls to Triple My Testosterone Levels." I picked up a red light device that emits 660 and 850 nanometer light at 68.6 watts, and I've noticed a couple things. If I leave it on my stomach for more than about 10 minutes, I feel pretty relaxed, kind of like the chilled out feeling you get from sunbathing at the beach. Since I'm new to CrossFit and have pretty bad form, my wrists are usually in pain for about 2 days after certain workouts. But if I apply the light to my wrists, they're back to normal about a day faster than usual. Then if I put it on my face, my skin seems to look a little better. Not that this comparison proves anything, but here's a microscope image of the same spot on my forehead before and after a 10-minute red light session. As you can see, these pores here seem to have become a lot less gross. So, what exactly is going on with red light? How is it any different from, you know, normal light? Let's rewind a bit back to 10th century Japan. People at the time believed in a smallpox god called Hosogami, who caused smallpox, and feared the color red. This superstition led them to decorating patients' rooms with red objects, red strips of paper, having people wear red clothes, and so on. In fact, many different cultures ended up adopting this practice. This was recommended in medical writings of medieval Arabic scholars and was practiced in England, France, Italy, Sweden, Denmark, and other areas. King Charles V of France, Elizabeth I of England, and Joseph I of Austria were all subjected to this bizarre practice of being surrounded with red stuff. Fast forward to 1903, Niels Finsen had just won the Nobel Prize for discovering that specific wavelengths of light could heal a terrible skin condition called lupus vulgaris caused by the tuberculosis bacteria. The ultraviolet light he used seemed to destroy the harmful bacteria. But before that, Finsen wrote in an 1895 paper how the superstitious red treatment for smallpox may have not been entirely baseless. At the time, it was understood that smallpox infected skin exposed to sunlight even briefly turned into deep scars. However, Finsen explained that if you block the sunlight with heavy red curtains and expose the patient to only red rays of light, this would actually promote healing of the skin and reduce scarring. The red rays were more beneficial than just complete darkness. This red light treatment was effective in 69 out of 70 patients across Denmark, France, and Sweden. Many of the practitioners were actually reserved in their reports on the results, probably for fear of being mocked and laughed at. Finsen was careful to write that this practice had beneficial effects only for the skin, but did not affect the smallpox infection itself. Again, Finsen was not saying red light cures smallpox, just that red light has healing effects on the skin. Even then, light that happens to be tinted red, healing the skin, may sound far-fetched. What also sounds far-fetched is saying, you know that terrible bone disease children get? You can cure it with this special lamp of mine. When Holchinski claimed in 1919 that you could treat rickets with a mercury arc lamp, everyone thought he was a nut. But now we know that rickets is caused by vitamin D deficiency, and UV rays from the sun, or rays from a UV lamp hitting the skin, allows the body to create vitamin D, which prevents rickets. Not many people bought the idea that red light could benefit the skin until André Mester miscalibrated a laser in 1968. In one of Mester's experiments, he made a cut on rodent's skin to implant a cancerous tumor. Then he tried to destroy it with a laser. The laser didn't kill the tumor, but interestingly, it healed the cut he made on the skin. This didn't make any sense. Why would the laser not destroy the tumor, but instead heal the skin? Actually, Mester's laser was much weaker than he realized. This accident revealed the skin healing effect of low-level lasers. Nowadays, LLLT, low-level laser therapy, has all kinds of applications with many research papers written about them. One of these skin applications is healing acne scars. Low-level laser therapy mostly uses red and near-infrared wavelengths of light from 660 to 905 nanometers because these penetrate into the body and have certain beneficial effects. You might be wondering why our bodies would be adapted to react specifically to red and near-infrared light. The sun has been worshipped and revered as a provider of health for quite a while now. Hippocrates had claimed that sunbathing was beneficial to health, and even up until recently, it was thought that the sun could help heal wounds. This 1918 photograph depicts wounded American soldiers exposing their unbandaged wounds to the sun to speed up healing. In 1933, the US government released a pamphlet called Sunlight for Babies, saying, Every mother who wishes her baby to have robust health should give him regular sun baths from early infancy until he is old enough to play in the sun himself. Nowadays, we're told to stay out of the sun unless we want to get skin cancer, but people are arguing that we need more sun because vitamin D is so important for health. However, the rising and setting sun specifically don't get too much attention. If you compare the range of wavelengths of light from the morning and midday sun, the morning sun has far more wavelengths in the 630 to 940 nanometer range. And actually, this is nearly the exact same range used in low-level laser therapy or red and near-infrared light therapy. So perhaps red and near-infrared lights aren't randomly magical, but are simulating something we used to get plenty of in our lives. Unless you sleep outside, you're probably not exposed very often to red and infrared rays from the morning or setting sun. Red light therapy has been claimed to have a positive effect on everything from skin health to Alzheimer's and depression. That sounds way too good to be true. So, how exactly does red light affect the cells? Well, to understand, let's take a look at cyanide poisoning. As you know, the mitochondria are the powerhouse of the cell. They produce energy in the form of ATP. Cyanide poisoning works by basically throwing a wrench in the mitochondria's ATP energy factory, which starves the cell of the precious energy it needs to operate. Cyanide inhibits an important enzyme in the mitochondria called cytochrome C oxidase. This is a key enzyme for producing lots of energy. When cytochrome C oxidase is inhibited, ATP production slows to a halt, and the powerhouse of the cell becomes the abandoned shack of the cell. And if this happens to enough cells, then you die.
Aw, jeez! Milhouse, how could you let this happen? You were supposed to-
Interestingly, red and near-infrared light works kind of opposite to cyanide. It actually stimulates this enzyme cytochrome C oxidase in a way that leads to more ATP energy production. Since nearly every single type of cell in the body relies on mitochondria to power them with energy from ATP, maybe it's not so far-fetched that light therapy would have such wide-ranging effects. By the way, because red and near-infrared light works essentially opposite to cyanide, it's actually been found to reverse some of the damage cyanide does to cells. This, of course, is just a fun fact. Red light isn't an antidote to cyanide poisoning. So, cells need energy. You shine red light on them, and then they're able to produce more energy, and they work better. It's an interesting concept and helps things make a bit more sense. If something can make a wide variety of cells essentially work better, we should expect that something to have beneficial effects on a wide variety of diseases where the mitochondria of the cells are not working properly. This seems to be what's going on with red light therapy. Let's take a look at three diseases red light is supposed to help with: diabetes, Parkinson's, and Alzheimer's. Notice I'm being very careful not to use any words like cure, but you might still be thinking, come on, really? Light is supposed to improve these? What's going on with type 2 diabetes? One feature of diabetes is a pancreas that doesn't work properly. And in diabetes, you see decreased energy production in the mitochondria of the pancreas, the organ that produces insulin. Another feature of diabetes is insulin resistance. One effect of insulin resistance on the cells is decreased energy production in the mitochondria. Next, what's going on with Parkinson's disease? This 2018 paper explains that overwhelming evidence shows that dysfunctional mitochondria are a central factor to Parkinson's. What about Alzheimer's? Again, one feature of this disease is also decreased energy production in the mitochondria of brain cells. One other thing about red light hitting this enzyme cytochrome C oxidase is that it releases nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a very important molecule. It acts as a neurotransmitter, helps heal damaged tissues, and relaxes blood vessels, increasing blood flow. Three men were awarded the Nobel Prize in 1998 for discovering nitric oxide's significant role in the cardiovascular system. Similar to how exposing a UVB light deficient child to the sun can have magical benefits on their bone health by curing their rickets, red and infrared light may have such wide-ranging benefits simply because modern people happen to be deficient in red and infrared light. something prehistoric humans would have gotten from the morning and evening sun every day. So let's get back to TBI, traumatic brain injury. Surprisingly, 1.7 million Americans receive treatment for TBI each year. And again, mitochondria come into play. As this paper explains, widespread damage to the mitochondria of the brain is a significant part of the symptoms seen from TBI. So, there is actually very solid evidence and logic for why Dr. Margaret Nacer had Larry Carr strap this red light emitting device to his head, and there's even solid science that explains why it had such significant benefits for him. Furthermore, a small 2009 study took 10 patients with a history of major depression and anxiety and applied red and near-infrared light to their forehead for 4 weeks. Amazingly, at the end of the 4 weeks, 6 out of the 10 patients' depression was in remission, and 7 out of the 10 patients' anxiety was in remission. Studies like this are very exciting, but as I said earlier, I've been very careful not to use words like cure in this video. So, should we all go out and drop a couple $100 on a red light device? Well, it's hard to say. Obviously, you won't get results as ridiculous as this, but to this collagen capsule thing's credit, there are actually many papers showing red light increases collagen synthesis. To what degree it actually beautifies your skin is hard to say, but if you're interested in red light for these skin or other benefits, it's worth looking into. If anything, hopefully this video encouraged you to try and get some early morning sun, which would be good for establishing a healthy circadian rhythm anyhow. Let's say NASA wants to use a swarm of self-replicating robots to explore Mars. First, NASA allows the robots to self-replicate in the Atacama Desert of Chile for several hundred generations, and then sends a dozen copies of the fastest reproducing robot with genotype 01111 to Mars. After several years, the robots have reproduced many times over, generating offspring well adapted to Mars. Then the robots send back this data. Then they send all those robots on Mars back to Atacama and let them reproduce for 100 more generations, and we get this data. So, why did the robots best adapted for the Mars environment perform even better in Atacama than the robots that were initially best adapted to the Atacama environment? If you'd like to know why, you'll have to check out Brilliant's computational biology course. If you're naturally curious or want to build your problem-solving or analytical abilities, you'll enjoy Brilliant's thought-provoking math, science, and computer science content designed to break complex scientific concepts down into understandable chunks, like this lesson on neural networks. It takes you from how a computer learns to play tic-tac-toe up to how artificial neurons are trained. With over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science, Brilliant will grow your understanding of our modern world with a structured and engaging approach. Check out brilliant.org/WIL, and the first 200 people to follow my link will get 20% off the annual subscription.